you. So let me introduce you. Today we have Gerard Hensler. So his main field is galaxy evolution and intergalactic medium, interstellar medium, sorry. Right now he's at the University of Vienna. So he did his PhD at the Göttingen in Germany. After that, he moved to Munich Observatory as an assistant professor. Then he was a full professor at Kiev. After that, he moved to Vienna Institute, where he was the director for several years. And he's been in charge of many things. And he's here because he's going to be in charge of the organization of the next IAU General Assembly in Vienna. So thanks for being here, Gerard, and welcome. Yeah.
Thank you for attending the talk. It's a pleasure for me to be here. It was my own fault that I offered the talk to Gustavo Buzual, because I met him on the IU's symposium in Toledo, and I told him that we have a meeting of the IU here, so I could also join him, but I had not expected that he's so distant from from this place here, because we have already some common interests on galaxy evolution, and I wish to learn something also from him and to discuss with him. So I proposed a topic where we are working already since years on that, which might, for people which are involved to galaxy evolution, and I guess also from the cosmology to structure formation and to our understanding of galaxy from morphology, it's a very interesting and I think exciting and not yet solved topic. For instance, what is the contribution of tidal tail dwarf galaxies to the normal population of dwarf galaxies? And can we, for instance, understand how they form, how they evolve, and whether they survive? But that is the main issue and reason why I'm here. We are organizing the General Assembly 2018 in Vienna, and I have the connection to the IU Executive Committee these next days. I hope you wish already to prepare for this IU General Assembly in Vienna. You can propose symposia and focus meetings end of this year in order also to organize something scientifically at, in Vienna. Vienna, you might know, it's a cultural city. It's the capital of Austria, not more than 1.8 million inhabitants. So it's not comparable to Mexico City, but it's very, I think, very, very nice because it's not too large. But let me come to the talk now. What are tidal tail dwarf galaxies? Since the 90s or so, we are more familiar, for instance, from deeper and more sensitive observations that obviously interacting galaxies show in their tidal tails, which are formed due to the tidal interaction between mergers or even close encounters of galaxies, that obviously some clumps are existing there. The gas is clumping there, and from observations, and that is from 92 of the last century, Felix Mirabel and Pierre Landuc or so, they found that in the outskirts of these tidal arms, there are, for instance, some knots which are showing directly the features, the spectral features of H2 regions. So obviously, star formation is occurring there. If we go deeper with more recent observations, we can also follow the kinematics of the gas, the kinematics of the stars. We know that there's an H1 bridge directly into these tidal clumps, and these clumps are connected by obviously the gas in the tidal arms. And we know also that there's some dynamics in the tidal arms. So the question is, why are these clumps forming? Can they, for instance, survive a star formation? And can they, for instance, also grow in order to be formed as dwarf galaxies? Here, it's again clearly visible in the different spectral ranges, far UV, near UV, that you have young massive stars formed there. And in addition, also in H1, there's a clear connection from the tidal tail to the merger galaxies. It's nearly everywhere where we look and where we see close encounters and merging of galaxies, knots are formed in the tidal tails, depending on the size of the tidal tails. But these knots obviously produce stars, and it's pretty clear that from the mass also that these entities could be comparable to dwarf galaxies. Here's, for instance, a dentist's chair, which shows a lot of knots in these arms. Approximately 12 dwarf galaxies are formed there. But by definition, what is a tidal tailed galaxy? It must be formed in the tidal arms. It should be form stars there. This means it should show up as H2 regions. It is a gas concentration first. We will see later the stars are not capable, for instance, to produce these dense clumps. They must form dissipatively. This means they must be formed from the gas. And it must, and it is from the from our understanding now of the encounters, these gas stems from the outer parts of disks of galaxies. So it is directly from the galaxy regions in the outer parts. The masses of these dwarf galaxies are of the order of 10 to the 8, even 10 to the 9 solar masses. So they're really, pardon? Oh, it's outside. So they're really comparable to normal dwarf galaxies, even to massive dwarf galaxies. They're gravitationally bound objects, obviously, from the kinematics we can discern this. They contain also an older stellar population. That is pretty clear. If you form, we will see this later in a movie, if you form, for instance, a gravitational trough, you can also accumulate stars. And these stars stem from the older galaxies. This means from the galaxies, from the merging galaxies, as older stellar populations. So we have a mixture of newly formed stars and also of old stellar populations. But surprisingly, and that is, I think, the main issue of the understanding these tidal-tailed dwarf galaxies, they should be free of dark matter. Because in the phase space, the dark matter particles are not in the same area as, for instance, because of the velocity dispersion, not in the same area of the phase space as these dwarf galaxies. So they should be free of binding dark matter. And that's the question whether they can survive without these binding additional mass. How do they form, for instance? What are the conditions for the tidal-tailed dwarf galaxies? This means we must understand under which conditions they are formed. Why is, for instance, dentist chairs polluted with a lot of these clumps? And in other cases, we only see 2-3 clumps and not more. Good question, but a little bit too early. I come to that later. this movie did not work this morning, so I show you the movie. Let me see, I have to go to the... to go there and show you the movie by Wettstein interacting, or this means of merging galaxies, and you see directly that there are clumps formed in the clumps are forming here in these tidal tails. There you see the clumps formed by gas. These are snapshots from the simulations by Wettstein, and you see, for instance, in which times, approximately 100 million years or so, you see these clumps which are formed. But these clumps here, for instance, are only formed by low-resolution n-body simulations. And if you go to more refined n-body simulations, this means with lower masses of the bodies, of the particles, the stellar component cannot form or cannot clump in the tails. So what we need is really, we need a gas, and that is the same simulation with gas. We need the gas in order to enhance the gravitational potential by condensation of gas and by the dissipative effects of the gas. The stars alone cannot form tidal-tailed dwarf galaxies. Only in older simulations, for instance, that could happen, like this is done here, for instance, in an old simulation by Barnes and Hernquist, which have a very low resolution, and because of the two-body interactions in these low resolution simulations, it could be formed, but it's not physically, it's not reasonable and not natural. We see that tidal T-dwarf galaxies here, for instance, in this tadpole galaxy, we see these very nice clumps there. The conditions, for instance, we have already mentioned. But what are the properties of these formed dwarf galaxies? And now we come to your question. Here's, for instance, interaction of a galaxy, NGC 4694 with VCC. And what you observe here is that are the far UV knots and also the gas distribution. But you see that there are also clumps in UV, in the far UV, which obviously are produced by formed stars. And if you look deeper into these fields, star formation in the clumps is directly correlated with the density of the H1. This means where the H1 is clumping, the stars are formed. That is a natural understanding of galaxy formation. That is pretty clear. If you look to the H1 mass of the order of 10 to the 8 solar masses, that is one of these integrated properties, for instance, the oxygen abundance is of the order of the abundance of the main galaxy. That is pretty clear. But the star formation rate is of the order only of 10 to the minus 3 solar masses per year. That is complicated later to understand how these galaxies really evolve with these low star formation rates. We compare, for instance, these are some clumps, for instance, here, some clumps in these observed objects. Here, for instance, in the tail of the antenna, we see that they do not differ, and that is, I do not wish to go into detail here, they do not differ, for instance, from the old stellar population and from normal dwarf galaxies, in the sense, if you look, for instance, to the color and to the total magnitude. But what we can, for instance, distinguish is we have different populations in these tidal-tailed dwarf galaxies. We have an old population of approximately 10 billion years, what is the age of the disk that is perturbed and that has, for instance, produced the tidal arms. We see a range of A stars, for instance, between 100 and 500 megayears age, but also a very young population, which is still in massive stars producing the H-alpha emission. But if you now compare, I mentioned already that they should be free of dark matter, but Pierre Landuc and Bourneau, they found that this is obviously not totally the case because they've revisited one of these merger galaxies and they found, for instance, from the observational mass that is a green curve here, for instance, the expected distribution of the rotation. That is also one very, intriguing parameter or issue, that these dwarf galaxies show already rotation. They are already here, you see, a clear rotation curve of comparable to isolated dwarf galaxies. But what we would expect is a rotation velocity of the green points here, and what is observed are the red ones. So they claim, for instance, that these galaxies should contain some dark matter. But some word of caution should be included. The one is, for instance, we have an object that is kinematically not in equilibrium. This means when we derive from the brightness of the galaxy, when we try to derive the virial mass, we should fail. And that is really one clear emphasis of caution which should be entered here and which should be observed here. Another point, for instance, is a baryonic dark matter. Is there baryonic dark matter? This means are there old stellar populations which do not contribute significantly to the luminosity? You can imagine, for instance, if you only accumulate old stars from the disk, and then you produce also with a very low star formation rate an IMF, which is then dominated by old stars, you underinterpret the luminosity and the mass, or mass to luminosity ratio, because usually one interprets, or this one derives the star formation rate from a luminosity taking into account that the IMF is filled. I will come to this point later. Another thing, for instance, to distinguish between the tidal-tailed dwarf galaxies and normal dwarf galaxies, these are normal dwarf galaxies, is their metallicity. The metallicity of normal dwarf galaxies declines with the mass of these dwarf galaxies. That is a clear correlation between both. But tidal tail dwarf galaxies are located at metallicities, and that is pretty clear, and we know this, we understand this. The metallicity stems from the disks of more massive galaxies, so the metallicity should be higher. And that is, could be something, for instance, to distinguish between the present-day dwarf galaxies and the normal isolated dwarf galaxies. But again, one word of caution, if we would look back and would try to distinguish now whether some of these dwarf galaxies which are visible here, for instance, are formed as tidal tail dwarf galaxies in the past, we cannot, for instance, play the same game because they evolved from disks which have a lower metallicity or had a lower metallicity. So this means we would shift this, for instance, the present observation down in redshift to lower metallicities, and then the question is, are they really distinguishable from normal field galaxy, dwarf galaxies? Here, for instance, are some objects also visible, or this means observed by Peebles, which have shown these outliers in the metallicity brightness relation, that is a normal relation for dwarf galaxies. They are much of higher metallicity, and these are isolated objects. They are not bound to mergers, for instance. And Peebles interprets this as transformation galaxies, but to my opinion, it is really one hint that these are galaxies which have disconnected from the mergers where they were formed from the tidal tails and are now free-floating through the intergalactic space. Next point, how many tidal tail dwarf galaxies are formed? If we would, for instance, take a merger rate into account, and if we could, for instance, directly derive how many dwarf galaxies are formed and survive, for instance, also their tidal tail history, then the question is really, can we produce all the dwarf galaxies which are visible now by interactions of major galaxies in these tidal tails? Here we see a lot of these objects, what I mentioned. I think it's even more, it must be 22 or something like that, even more than 12, what I mentioned before. And they are visible as knots, really, and the question is, for instance, how many of them would survive and become later also visible. Here's another distribution, for instance, accumulated and archived by Pierre-Alain Duc, where we see the ultraviolet, and the ultraviolet is showing that here, for instance, in all these arms, stars are formed. This means if we look to an interacting galaxy system, we expect that stars are formed and that dwarf tidal tail dwarf galaxies are also produced there. In a simulation, for instance, by Frédéric Bourneau and Pierre-Alain Duc, they, for instance, counted here for approximately 7 objects, and what survived is, for instance, here one object that is escaping from the whole system. B would also escape from the system, and the other fall back or are destroyed. This means out of 7 or 8 objects, 2 would survive as isolated objects disconnected from the mergers. This means 25%, and that is not less. There are other estimates, for instance, by Okazaki and Taniguchi, which expect 100% survivors, but only 2 tidal tail dwarf galaxies per merger, approximately. Others here, what is Bourneau and Duc, what I mentioned already, 25%. Kavirai expected 10% from, they derived this from SDSS and the Galactic Zoo mergers. And Wen et al. Derived much less, 3% only. So that is obviously a clear variety of so how many of these objects are formed and how many of these objects can survive. And the question is, how can we identify detached tidal tail dwarf galaxies from normal dwarf galaxies which are formed in our classical lambda CDM scenario? The question is, how do they survive? They are less bound because dark matter is missing there. They shows star formation activities. This means also the stars are releasing energy, and whether they can, for instance, avoid disruption by the energy release of the massive stars is one problem. First order problem. And they are also stretched by tidal forces. So the stretching, for instance, could also disrupt these tidal tail dwarf galaxies. So how should they survive? Here's a statistics by Bourneau and Duke from their simulations, for instance, that 200 mega years, this is the upper curve here, very faint curve. Many of them are formed in the outer regions of the tails, not in the inner regions of the tails. Then some of these objects are falling back after 500 mega years, a smaller fraction survived, and after 2 giga years, only the outer parts, this means those which are formed already detached, pretty out far away from the merging system, they can survive. The rest has fallen back or is disrupted by the tidal field. This means that is something, those which can survive, they are really formed at the tips of the tidal arms. But, and that is one problem, the contribution, for instance, should or could be less here, for instance, could be less than 10% at most. But if we produce sufficient, let's say we produce 20 tidal tail objects and only 10% survives, that is two dwarf galaxies that survive the merging. Galaxies, and the question is how many mergers have been happened in the past. How one can distinguish these tidal tail dwarf galaxies from regular galaxies? Until now, it's only possible to see a clear connection here, for instance, of tidal tail dwarf galaxies with a merging parent galaxy. And these tidal tail dwarf galaxies here have ages of 2 to 4 billion years. If they are, for instance, detached, this means disconnected, if they have left the system, the gravitational binding of the system, and are free floating in the field, it's really hard to understand where they stem from. But some hint, for instance, what I mentioned already by the observations of Peebles, shows that there are some objects in isolation, this means in the field, which could stem from these interactions of dwarf galaxies. The interesting point is these galaxies, all these older objects of 2 to 4 billion years, they have approximately 10 to 8 solar masses in gas, and also in the UV, the star formation rate is low, but I can show you later also from models, there should be, for instance, some bursts of star formation due to tidal compression. And then the stars which are formed, they are gravitational bound, and these objects should survive. If we compare, for instance, in the baryonic Tully-Fisher relation, where the tidal tail dwarf galaxies are located, these are these objects here. We could not distinguish them from regular dwarf galaxies. And the same is, for instance, in the field of stellar mass with a projected half-light radius. These are the objects, these are for instance, globular clusters and also ultra-compact dwarf galaxies. And here are the normal regular galaxies. These are here fireballs from these interacting galaxies. And these are the regular galaxies. This means regular, those which are in the field and which are understood from our scenario, they are formed in the lambda CDM cosmology. And you see that we cannot really distinguish these objects, the tidal tail dwarf galaxies, from field galaxies which are disconnected from any source. And that's a question whether these objects here are all bound or are all found formed from interacting galaxies. The problems to be addressed is, what is their kinematics, for instance? How they form with the gas concentration, but how long can they survive, for instance, in the tidal field? How is the star formation affected by tides? Is the low star formation rate and the tidal field, for instance, keeping them bound? Is that, let's say, some conditions that kept them bound? How to distinguish? That is one problem I've already addressed. And how old are the tidal tail dwarf galaxies look like? If they have low metallicity and high gas fraction and so on, are they really distinguishable from field dwarf galaxies? In order to understand this, it's always, it's not simple, but I think it's necessary really to have numerical simulations, because otherwise we do not understand the physical processes. Numerics, for instance, help us to understand complex systems because they are complexly coupled, and we cannot, for instance, predict in a linear regime, for instance, how these dwarf galaxies evolve. For instance, what is the contribution of the tidal field? What is the contribution of the star formation and the stellar energy release? So what we have done, for instance, is we have already started with single, that means isolated, dark matter-free dwarf galaxies in 1D and in 2D in order to see whether these galaxies are disrupted by, without dark matter, for instance, disrupted by the energy release of massive stars. That was the first hint, for instance, what could happen. Then we continued to 3D numerical models of tidal tail dwarf galaxies with the initial condition of a merger, but dark matter-free also, and in the tidal field of the merger, and also with hot halo gas. But we could not, for instance, we produced them in an isolated regime. This means we could not, for instance, follow the whole gas accumulation and star accumulation in the stream itself, in the tidal tail itself. And that is done recently now by a student of mine. When we zoomed in into the simulations, for instance, what could do this before is the Wettstein simulations. We have taken simulations by François Amer, where we zoomed in and could, for instance, follow the evolution of these dwarf galaxies with their surrounding material. These are 3D chemodynamical models. Chemodynamical means we take the chemistry into account of different components of a hot gas phase, of a cool gas phase, of the stellar component. We allow for interaction between the gas and the stars by star formation, also by energy release, and also by mass release of the stars themselves, galactic winds. Gas cooling is taken into account. The yields and the stellar lifetimes are taken into account. Here are all the recipes which we have published, for instance, in different papers already, so you should look to that. The only free parameter is really the supernova efficiency. All the parameters are fixed by theoretical and empirical relations. So the free parameters which enter our simulations is the supernova efficiency. This means how much energy from supernova explosions is deposited in the interstellar medium. That is still a free parameter because it depends really on the shape of the superbubbles of the supernovae, on the surrounding material, and should not be parameterized. It should be automatically come out from the simulations. But you cannot do this if you cannot go deeper into the spatial resolution of the simulations. That is not feasible. We should go down to less than one parsec resolution. That is not feasible for us. And the IMF is also a free parameter. You can say, oh, the IMF is empirically constant, but that is obviously not the case. Recent observations have shown this. Then we started with, for instance, an inhomogeneous model where we have allow for some clumps in. We took, for instance, a radius of a dwarf galaxy of approximately 4.5 kiloparsecs, then 1/3 of solar metallicity in a merger merger mass of 10 to the 12 solar masses with a density of the surrounding hot material, of the halo material, of only 10 to the minus 6 particles per cubic centimeter, but very hot. This means a hot halo gas that exerts rem pressure to the dwarf galaxy so that also gas could be lost from the dwarf galaxy on an eccentric orbit. The orbit has a what is it, pericentrum of 50 kiloparsecs and an apocentrum of 132 kiloparsecs, but no rotation, for instance. This means we looked for isolated objects, and here are some how they are looking like when we compare them with the simulations of Pierre Landuc and Frédéric Bourneau, where they are located and how they look like. Here you see how they are stretched, for instance, in the tidal field, and what the star formation, for instance, looks like. Here is, for instance, one dwarf galaxy, interacting galaxy, which is a merger of three objects and shows a nice chain of tidal tail dwarf galaxies. And UMI derives the star formation rate of these objects. We come out only with 10 to the minus 3 to 10 to the minus 4 solar masses per year. Very low star formation rate, but they can be obviously observed as H2 regions. But now something important really enters. And that could, let's say, help to produce or to keep these galaxies also bound. If you take the star formation rate into account, and if you allow, for instance, a star formation, or this means a pre-cluster evolution of 1 million years, and you would, for instance, take, let's say, a star formation rate of 10 to the minus 2 solar masses per year into account, you would only end up with 10,000 solar masses in the star cluster itself. And with 10,000 solar masses, you can really, and that is a Kuiper IMF, you can really produce and fill the Kuiper IMF until the most massive star, let's say at 100 solar masses, is one single star only. But that has consequences. If you go further down, this means star formation rates of 10 to the minus 3 or 10 to the minus 4 solar masses per year only allow you to produce something of 1,000 solar masses, star clusters of 1,000 solar masses and below. And if you have, for instance, a star cluster of 100 solar masses, you would not, for instance, try to convince me that you can follow the and produce a full IMF. Because either you produce 100 solar mass star and then the rest is empty, or you produce low mass stars and then you have a gap in the massive star range. And that has really consequences. Obviously, that can be observed. Here's, for instance, if we take different star formation rates into account, and we would produce, and that is our simple picture now, if we would produce the star cluster from the low mass end to the upper mass end, we can terminate the mass where we cannot form less than one single star, and that is, for instance, here visible at the different, here's a mass, at the different cutoffs at the upper mass range. And that has consequences for the galaxy. This is pretty clear. If you have lower massive stars, for instance, the supernova number is lower. This means the supernova rate is lower. This means the energy that is deposited by supernovae is less. And that has a consequence here, for instance, that the truncated IMF at the beginning has a higher star formation rate than the filled IMF. The filled IMF, for instance, is lower. This means supernova energy release is lower. I do not wish to go to the Lyman continuum radiation and stellar winds. That is different, but the supernova energy is lower. And this means the self-regulation of the star formation is higher for the filled IMF. This means we produce less stars there. And if we compare now what is the cluster mass that is located in our tidal tail dwarf galaxy. Here, for instance, that is in a range of T1, and that is the range of T2 here, around 100 mega years, and here around 300 mega years. Here we have, for instance, a distribution that is a star formation rate per unit area. The star formation is distributed all over the galaxy, but in the later in the next evolutionary step, we have it concentrated only in a few clumps. And these few clumps, for instance, can produce a full IMF because the star formation rate is low, but it is only concentrated to a few to form a few star clusters. And so we form here star clusters which have a higher mass end in the range of 60, 80 solar masses. But that was not the case, for instance, in the early phase of the evolution. That's the reason why we have here an underrepresentation of massive stars. And this self-regulation then is lower for a truncated IMF than for a filled IMF. Because here we have approximately the upper mass end at 10 solar masses, 8 solar masses. This means we are really have a lack of massive stars in these simulations. That is, for instance, I do not wish to go into details here. That is how a galaxy looked like in the tidal field of the gas contribution in the tidal field of the of a merger only in the tidal field without the, for instance, the environment of the arms, and that is a stellar distribution. But what we can tell already from these simulations is that both kind of simulations, the truncated IMF and also the filled IMF, all these galaxies survive. This means we followed them for 3 billion years and they survived this time. This means they are obviously not disrupted on their path around the galaxy. Then we took another model into account. We could, for instance, look, if you would form a dwarf galaxy in an extending tidal arm, you would expect that also the kinematics in the tidal arm, for instance, would contribute to the dynamics of the tidal tail dwarf galaxy in it itself. If you have, for instance, a shear motion in the arm, you would produce rotation in the tidal tail dwarf galaxy itself. And we compare now here, for instance, the simulation of a simulation of an isolated galaxy, not in a tidal field, in order only to show you how, for instance, that it's not running now. And now it's running. We see that this galaxy, that is a stratified galaxy, either thermally stratified, you see the in some clumps, star formation is produced, and these, what is it, these holes which you observe there are supernova explosions. This galaxy rotates, obviously the computer is not fast enough. The galaxy rotates, but it keeps the shape approximately as it was before. Let me go back again and show you the tidal tail dwarf galaxy. That is now the galaxy in the tidal field of the merger itself. At the beginning, the same conditions, but now the tidal field and the galaxy really moves along the 2 minutes, moves along the orbit. And what you see, for instance, is the galaxy is stretched. It has a very compact core, and in the compact core, there are so many stars produced that that even with supernova explosions, only the outer parts of the gas are stripped off, but the central part is gravitationally bound. Good question, yeah. It is, that is one of the next steps. Because I'm running out of time, I should go a little bit quicker. That is how it looks like, for instance, when the galaxy turns around here on this orbit, eccentric orbit. It seems that the outer parts are disrupted, but the central part is really stabilized, and it has a mass of 10 to the 8 solar masses and even above. And now we can, for instance, produce something. Here we can compare, for instance, the star formation rate. The star formation rate for the isolated galaxy was pretty low, but for the tidal tail dwarf galaxy, we have here, for instance, an increase to approximately 1/10 of solar masses at the beginning. That is after 3 billion years long, for instance, how this takes, and the galaxy is, because of this production of stars, there's not sufficient gas around anymore, the gas is driven out also, this galaxy really remains bound. And in order to come to your question, that is, for instance, something also one can compare then with galaxies which are in the field and with tidal tail dwarf galaxies. What we observe is that oxygen over iron reaches values below solar. And now you might be surprised, which are, for instance, familiar only with galaxy evolution in our Milky Way. We can only reach solar, approximately solar, in oxygen over iron, and oxygen over iron in the halo was approximately at 0.5. But dwarf galaxies which are observed, for instance, dwarf spheroidal galaxies in our environment, they also drop below solar. So that seems to be really a characteristic issue for dwarf galaxies that are produced in these tidal tails. And another very interesting point is we observe, for instance, in the Virgo cluster, that is our consortium here, the SMACSAT consortium, we have observed 4 objects, tidal tail dwarf galaxies in the Virgo cluster, which show kinematically decoupled cores. This means counter rotation in the cores, and that is visible here, for instance. That is one object here. You see, for instance, the central part rotating in that direction, and the outer part is rotating in the other direction. And it's not clear how you can, for instance, produce dwarf galaxies which show this counter rotation in the central part, because they have not sufficient mass to accrete material. And for instance, mergers, when mergers of dwarf galaxies happen, that is not very frequent, that is really almost improbable, so it can approximately not happen. But what we could produce with galaxies in the tidal field, and that is one object, I do not wish to go into detail here, we can produce in the tidal field of the galaxy, because we have the differential rotation which stems from the tidal arm itself, and then the whole tidal arm, for instance, moves in the around the merger galaxies. This means we have also a torque which, for instance, is exerted to the tidal tail dwarf galaxy. So if you produce something that rotates according to the differential rotation in the one direction, and then you move the tidal arm in the other direction and exert the torque on the dwarf galaxy, you produce, due to this torque, the outer parts co-rotating. And that is what we see here for the gas component. We see directly here is a velocity in one of our objects, for instance, I do not wish to go into details, so it looks here, for instance, in the velocity coloring, that there's pretty clearly, obviously, a counter-rotating dwarf galaxy formed with a counter-rotating core. May I have one minute more? Now let me only go in order to show you the most recent simulations. We took directly a knot in the tidal arm here. We took one of these knots here, for instance, this knot from simulations by François Amer and his group. Bin Yang is one of the numerical people who has done this. And show you what, for instance, happens. It starts very slowly. It's not moving, yeah? It is? Yeah, but too slowly. Because I do not wish to waste your time. No, sorry, it does not. The computer is not fast enough. Yeah, let me go to, I hope that I can go to the, yeah, it always stops, obviously. Yeah, now it's only, it's not, I only wish to show you which object we consider there in the tidal stream directly, and how this, for instance, looks like when we then zoom in, and with the surrounding material also, we know, for instance, how this behaves dynamically, and we have infall and outflow into our dwarf galaxy, which is located in this box there. That is the gaseous component, and now you see how the gaseous component, for instance, is compressed and is really accumulating gas in the galaxy itself. Oh, it's very slow. And how the galaxy looks like. That is now the gaseous component. For instance, the phase on or surface gas density. We see how this develops, but we always get a core that is bound, and that is this core here that can survive. And let me go now to the last transparency in order to show you what are the parameters of this dwarf galaxy that is formed there. Here, for instance, is the total mass in the galaxy, that is the gaseous mass, is here in blue, and the stellar mass is in red. That is the part in the very center, and the other, the faint lines are out to 5 kiloparsecs, and here's the total mass. And we see that the total mass, for instance, increases of the galaxy increases by approximately a factor of 2. This means this galaxy is really increasing up to 10 to the 9 solar masses. That is really an entity like the small Magellanic Cloud. The star formation rate is of the order of, is pretty high, is more than 1 solar masses per year, and then it goes down to 1 solar mass per year. But this object is obviously bound and can survive. And so the issues of our results are that tidal tail dwarf galaxies stem from the parent merger objects. Their shape is distorted, but it leads to rotation and enhanced velocity dispersion. That is pretty clear. And so we should not misinterpret the velocity of these objects which are observed, because they are not falsely with their mass, with their virial mass, because it's not in equilibrium. We cannot derive an equilibrium mass for these objects. The star formation rates differ significantly. The dwarf galaxies also feel REM pressure. That is also included in our models of the hot gas of the halo, hot halo gas of the merger themselves. The models are not disrupted. That is something very important you should keep in mind, even with high star formation rates. The survival probability is higher at lower metallicities. This means at higher redshift, we could produce more tidal tail dwarf galaxies than at the moment. This means high redshift tidal tail dwarf galaxies survived more frequently. And from our interpretation, we could really produce all the, this means the whole set, the whole sample and morphological type of dwarf galaxies by tidal interactions if the merger rate is reliable, what is derived from observations. The compression leads to high star formation rate and to the growth of the stellar mass, so it's really not surprising that we come up with 10 to the 9 solar masses. The question is, for instance, what is their population in the total dwarf galaxy population if it's only a fraction? Can we really discriminate between both evolution or formation scenarios? And that is still not solved. Thank you for your patience. And for,
just a couple of questions, because we have also Morelia.
Okay, yeah, really are very interesting objects, these, because offer an opportunity to study galaxies in a completely different context. So two questions in this aspect. Regarding the star formation rate, I would like to know if these galaxies follow the usual Kennicott-Schmidt law, because the star formation, I think, is completely different, as you mentioned it. Mm-hmm. So this is the first question about if they follow the usual Kennicott-Schmidt law. And the second is related more to the global galaxy. Since there are no dark matter halos here, so there is no a mechanism to stabilize the disks. So I would expect that most of these galaxies should end as spheroids, because no way to keep the thin disks as usually is in the case of dark matter dominion. Yeah? Like globular clusters should end. I would speculate that. Yeah,
they could end up as ultra-compact dwarf galaxies. If they remain in the tidal field of the major merger or so, and that is what is observed, the ultra-compact dwarf galaxies have some connection to major galaxies. And this could be the survivors in the tidal field. But those which dissolve from the mergers, they can evolve, let's say, for instance, like dwarf galaxies, which we observe a lot of dwarf galaxies with low mass to light ratios, lower than what is expected from cold dark matter scenario. If we have, for instance, done this also in the Virgo cluster, at a range of 10 to the 9 to 10 to the 10 solar masses in total, we have mass to light ratios which go down for dwarf galaxies to 3. That is surprising for many observers and surprising for people which really support the cold dark matter scenario and do not allow any compromise or contradiction to that. But that cannot be with a mass to light ratio of 3. That cannot be produced in our lambda CDM cosmology, but is observed. So is there, for instance, some, but also with a scatter, is there, for instance, some possibility and probability of lambda CDM dwarf galaxies with higher mass-to-light ratios and those with lower, and those which are lower are dark matter free approximately. And coming to your first question, to the Kenny-Kutch-Schmidt law,
they follow.
They, with a high star formation rate, they are above the Kenny-Kutch-Schmidt law. And the reason is that the Kenny-Kutch-Schmidt law represents an equilibrium in the balanced situation, self-regulated star formation in a disk which has already settled, and the disk size, this means the column density of the gas, is according to the star formation and produces the stars. Here we have the compression of the tidal field. We have really a tidal compression mode which can be derived, that was already done, for instance, for the antenna galaxies, that there are some regions where the tidal field does not disrupt exceed the gravitation. It adds to the gravitation and it compresses the galaxies. And there, the star formation rates are higher than the Kenny-Kutch-Schmidt relation. And that is, we know this from mergers. We know this in the central part of mergers, also at high redshifts. There's a Kenny-Kutch-Schmidt relation is not with an exponent of 1.4, but we come up with 2 to 2.3, much higher. In the mergers themselves, but the same is also in the tidal field of the dwarf galaxies.
Okay, one last question here.
Thank you. Do the simulations take into account a viscous term in the gas at any point in the process?
It's not directly a description of the viscosity, because the resolution is so that the viscosity should be on these scales, it should be inherent in the dynamics. It's not an additional viscosity what you would, for instance, take into account if you go to would you go to a higher resolution, like, for instance, in accretion disks or something like that, where you add a viscosity term which is something like a solid state or so, something like this. Here the viscosity is automatically included by streaming motions. On this resolution, it's not an additional viscosity term. And that's the same question what people are often asking, whether we take magnetic fields into account. On these larger scales, for instance, the magnetic fields do not dominate. We know, for instance, that the gas which is expelled from galaxies takes the magnetic, or opens the magnetic field. So this means they are not in energy equipartition. Magnetic field energy density is lower, and that's the reason on these scales that we can really neglect magnetic fields at the zeroth order, and also the viscosity.
Morelia, do you have any question?
It seems we don't have questions here.
Okay, so one last question here.
Thanks.
One question. Typically, these tidal dwarf galaxies. Hello.
Are you there? You're not there.
Okay. Typically, these tidal dwarf galaxies are high surface brightness or low surface brightness?
They have high surface brightness.
High surface brightness. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that is the reason that when they still remain in the tidal field, we would expect that they end up as UCDs, ultra-compact dwarf galaxies. Because you see that they get rid of their outer parts in the tidal field, and only the very central clump remains with a surface brightness of globular clusters.
Okay.
But when they detach, they might accumulate more gas, and then they show up as regular dwarf galaxies. That is something in the field we cannot tell how they look like. They should not be as compressed because they do not lose the outer parts, and then they have sufficient gas in order to continue star formation on a low rate that is observed also.
Okay, thanks very much. Let's thank Gerard again.
Thank you. And thanks for coming. This is exceptional time.
So we have a 5 minutes break now. So please come back in 5 minutes. Hello. Thanks everyone for staying. So now our second colloquium is going to be given by Ewin von Dieshoek. Ewin did originally her PhD at Leiden. So after that, she was for 6 years in the USA at Harvard, Princeton, and Caltech, very impressive. So after that, in 1990, she went back to Leiden, so where she's been since. And at 2007, also, she became an associate researcher at Garching and at MPI. And now here also for IAU things. And so Ewin is going to talk about some sweet results from Africa. So welcome, Ewin.
Okay, good. Well, good afternoon, everybody, and thanks for coming back for the second pre-lunch talk. It's my pleasure to be visiting here. We are having some discussions on IAU issues in the next few days, but it's always good to also discuss science with the local people here around. And so I've already had some very exciting discussions this morning, and I look forward to having some more scientific discussions also in the afternoon. Good, so after sort of talks on galaxy scales, I'm now gonna take you to the very smallest scales, namely the scales of protoplanetary disks. And this is really an area where ALMA is starting to make a very significant impact, and I hope to show you some of that. So not all of you may be familiar with this topic, so I'm going to start with probably one picture that you are all familiar with, namely the iconic images that the Hubble has taken of protoplanetary disks. Even though disks were predicted to be the natural outcome of star formation already centuries ago, it was not until about 20 years ago that final proof of the existence of these disks was actually given by these kinds of images that you see here of the Orion Nebula. Now we're 20 years later, and now ALMA is starting to produce some of its iconic images. So here is the fantastic image of a young disk. This is actually a disk that is still in an embedded phase of star formation. But you see already the enormous amount of detail that we now see. And this has been interpreted in terms of forming planets, although that is certainly not the unique interpretation of these beautiful data. But the main point is that so far, these kind of images were only simulations. And now these are no longer simulations. Now these are real data, actually, that we are having on these protoplanetary disks. And they are really on the scales of our own solar system, as you can see here in the comparison with the orbit of Neptune. Now, until a couple of weeks ago, this was the only system that we had at this high angular resolution. Just a few weeks ago, this fantastic image also appeared from ALMA of another more mature disk, a very nearby disk, already a little bit of an old disk around the star TW Hydra. And again, you see here these rings, actually very symmetric. It's not like there are sort of spiral arms in here, which is another challenge for modelers. And you can now actually start to zoom in here on a sort of Earth-like scale, because this system is so close, you can actually start to see gaps here on the orbit of the Earth. So 1 AU resolution that we now have. So these are fantastic images from ALMA that we are now starting to get. On the other hand, also scattered light images on these high on contrast instruments like GPI, but also VLT Sphere here. Of one of these transitional disks, and you see here now these fantastic structures appearing. So it's clear that this is sort of setting the stage for a new era in disk evolution studies. So what I'm going to do here is take you on a sort of a whirlwind tour through the various stages of disks. First young disks when they are still forming, which is not as trivial as you might think to form these disks. A little bit about disk around pre-made sequence stars, although I've shortened both of these parts somewhat to shorten my talk a little bit. But then I'll spend most of my time on the transitional disks, which are sort of the exciting part where we think planet formation is actually happening at this very moment. So this work has been done in collaboration with quite a number of my students and postdocs, and their names are listed down here, and it's really a tribute to all of them. this fantastic work, and I hope to highlight their individual contributions in the following slides. So again, to orient yourself, what are we talking about? Well, here is the disks around the young stars, the pre-main sequence stars, but really all of it starts already in the earlier phase when you have the molecular clouds, first the diffuse clouds and then the dense clouds that can actually collapse under their own weight and form a protostar here in the center. And because of the angular